Seems fair to me.
Donnybrook is made possible by the support of the Betsy and Thomas Patterson Foundation and the members of 9PBS.
Thank you so much for joining us for this edition of Donnybrook. Great to have you with us on this, the last edition for September. Where did the year go? Let's talk about a lot of hot topics, but first meet the panelists, starting with Wendy Wiese from KTRS, Mr. Bill McClellan from the Post-Dispatch, Ray Hartmann from KTRS, RawStory.com, and the Riverfront Times, and from the St. Louis American, Mr. Alvin Reid. Well, a shocker to some anyway, Wendy Wiese, when the Archdiocese of St. Louis announced that two schools, one of which started in 1912, the other in 1931, would be closing. We're talking about St. Mary's and South Grand, where our beloved founder, Martin Dugan, got his sheepskin back in the day. And Rosati Kane, a great school that produced many great alums, including Ellen Foley, who sang with Meatloaf.
That's
so
right. That's
just
right.
Among the many. What do you think about this? And Steve Butts, state representative, was quoted as saying, it's devastating for South St. Louis, at least St. Mary's anyway.
It is devastating for South St. Louis, but I'm sure in the same way that when, I believe it was called Northside Catholic, McBride, in North St. Louis, when it closed, these things are cyclical. And when you have enrollment going down precipitously, when you have cost going up, there's really no other choice. I don't think that this is over. I do think it's kind of interesting to contrast the amount of ink, and maybe that's just because of the enrollment today, because Rosati Kane's enrollment has certainly dipped. But you're barely hearing Rosati Kane mentioned compared to St. Mary's. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure why that is, but I know that people in St. Louis, we do not like change. And this is unfortunately part of a new era and a transforming time.
Wendy, the picture behind you and that bobblehead of Martin.
Yeah.
His head is shaking.
Is it shaking? Is he mad?
He's angry at how casual you were about this.
Oh, he's mad. I'm not trying to be casual.
You know, and Rosati Kane, I know one of the nuns who worked there, and I think she was even educated there, Sister Vincella, if she's watching. And she just made me believe in the mission of that school. And Tim O'Neill had a daughter who went there, and it was for the girls who weren't necessarily into sports and who were a little bit artsier,
right,
and different.
Right.
And I don't mean hippies, but leaning in that direction. And it's really sad that all that is ending, I think.
Well, and I agree. I
know. So you're not dancing on their graves because you're a Viz gal.
I am absolutely okay. Because I think change is coming in every educational institution in St. Louis eventually.
When you talk about the coverage, what I saw, and I have made a kind of a decades-long policy of not, you know, going after questioning the archdiocese or whatever. However, in this case, what was interesting about it was St. Mary's got more coverage because the parents, you know, Francis Slay and others, were, you know, kind of defiant.
They are defiant.
And they want the Independent Catholic School Association to come in, and I don't know anything about that. But whereas Rosati Kane, there didn't seem to be any of that expression, which I think would account for the difference in coverage. And I'm curious as to why.
But Bill is right. The loss for each institution is the same.
No, it is. And why do you think that one school's being more defiant than the other?
I think it's boys' school versus
school.
But
it's also early. Don't you think the real issue is, as we found out from the census, one out of five kids in the city of St. Louis moved out in the last 10 years.
That's right.
Last year, the St. Louis Public Schools announced 8 school closures. Mm-hmm. And this is just the beginning for the Archdiocese because they haven't even gotten to the grade schools yet.
Well that's true. I'm sorry, Alvin, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say that there have been a couple of national stories that
Catholic schools in urban settings are what are some of the ones that are closing. Now, the numbers are lower. So you can't immediately say, like, well, you know, there's more black girls going to school there than white girls or whatever, because there just aren't a lot of people in the school. But with that being said, I think that's all the more reason to protect that school, because it has created its own little niche, and be it, you know, it's a Catholic school, which means it's a private school, but at the same time, I just think if you're a part of the fabric of some community, but that something has
to... But the fabric is tattered. I mean, the fact that Dutchtown has such soaring crime rates, and we had a caller the other day who said that that St. Mary's is quite literally a rose in a thorn bush.
Okay. Alvin, I want to ask you, speaking of schools, I was a little surprised to see the high schools out there that have decided to cooperate with this new law. I think it's called 775, which says that high schools in Missouri cannot provide explicitly sexual material to the students. And so now librarians are taking books even on an anatomy off the shelves. They're taking 1984 off the shelves. Clayton took 5 off. Kirkwood, your alma mater, took 14, I think.
Yeah. And, you know, I've said exactly how I feel about it, but I can't hide my, really, just my, oh, just how disenchanted I am with Kirkwood. Because you're being scared into doing something. And the communication is that, well, because it's a law, and we don't want any employee to be subject to being charged with a crime. And I'm just like, no, that's not good enough. They are relying on the fear of these school districts to make this happen. And I think if you just stand up to the bully and say no, the bully goes away.
And if you don't stand up, the bully continues.
Going,
it won't end.
It will
today it's
end.
Material. Well, it's going to be music. It's going to be plays.
Right.
Whatever.
And the Mouse, the graphic novel Mouse about the Holocaust, I mean, I remember reading that, and it was never anything but a graphic novel, and it was spellbinding. And the idea that kids in middle school and high school cannot read that about the Holocaust, it's shocking
well,
to me.
It's, you know, to what you're saying, there's this talk about, well, we don't want to go to jail. Check with a lawyer and see how many times a misdemeanor, which, by the way, the large majority of prosecutors have made very clear they're not prosecuting, but a misdemeanor and a first offending librarian, we're not talking about jail. And the fact that that word even comes up, I'm bringing it up tonight, keeps coming up, have some guts here and stand for something.
Doesn't the legislation allow the attorney general to prosecute these crimes?
Nobody's going to prosecute these crimes. It's
really?
All a bluff. Yes.
Some attorney general looking for publicity is not good. It is
a bluff. And the only time Eric Schmidt, unless they decide to have another MAGA primary next year, either Eric Schmidt's going to be in the Senate.
I don't care if it is a bluff.
They're not going to prosecute. No, that's not the argument.
Okay. That's not the argument. Well, I mean, they may have already thrown somebody in jail. They might be doing time in some state.
You know,
but Kirkwood, don't give in to it.
No, I agree with that.
All school districts.
But I'm saying it is a bluff.
Earlier this year, we talked about Wentzville, and I believe we talked about The Bluest Tie by Toni Morrison.
Right.
I don't think I read that until I was in college. And frankly, when I think of some of the content in that book and other books that I read in college, I don't know that a middle schooler. I don't know that.
Can I make one real quick point? When I was in fourth grade, and times were like so much better than they are now. Two things changed my world. The movie The Hangman, and believe it or not, we saw the short film The Lottery. Now look both those up, and we watched those in fourth grade.
Yeah. But to address Wendy's concern, I think schools will allow your mother or some student's mother to put his or her name at the library desk and say, you know, the questionable books, Bobby or Wendy can't.
I don't care. The bottom line is this should not be done in any respect by either party, partisan or legislators trying to make a political point. And your school, to your concern, which might be very valid, that's what your school board and your school district and the librarians are for.
But that's better or worse. You're right. They're in the business of education.
And of course, the kids with their phones are able to access all sorts of
May I just put in a quick plug for the St. Louis County Library, which has many of these books on the table. It's called the banned book section. And I think you'll like this. They also have a section of books with music, and they call that the banned book section as well.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I like that. I like that.
Yep, yep.
Bill McClellan, I want to ask you, as you know, Missouri has this weird quirk where it taxes property, both real estate and your vehicles. Could be your boat or your car. And
it's not my boat.
Okay. Yeah.
Not the yard. I have two used cars, my wife.
Okay. Well, those used cars are appreciating in value because of inflation. And as a result, the state law says the assessor has to reassess them every couple of years. The price of your car, which has been in the garage, maybe you're not even using it, is going up in value. And the percentage that the state uses or the county to tax it is remaining the same. So your taxes are going up. While you sleep, your car is appreciating in value. So St. Charles County decided we're going to dial that back a little bit. Not much, but some. Don't you think that other governmental entities should do the same to give Jack and Jill Sixpack a little break?
No, I don't. I think that inflation hits everybody, including the governments. Everybody's paying a little more. So if my 2013 Honda goes up in value and I have to pay a little extra on it, that's fine, because the services that I want from my government are costing a little more, too. And I want those services. I mean, if I call 911, I want a police response. If I want the streetlights to work. I want everything
to
work.
The garbage to get picked up.
Yeah, yeah. Right. So if everything costs a little more and my Honda's worth a little more, I'll pay a little more.
Well, I respectfully disagree, because the other taxes are going up, too. If you pay the 1% earnings tax in the city, chances are your wages are going up, so that's going up. Sales taxes, because the products and services you buy, they're more expensive, so the sales tax, you're paying more sales tax than you were a year or so ago. And as a result, the little guy, especially if he's making more money on that income tax, that's going up. I think that the taxes are going to kill Jack and Jill.
Well, and Steve, didn't Steve Ellman say that the services wouldn't be impacted at all? That this is just their way of providing some relief for their citizens?
Well, it might be, but then when something does get cut, all right, you know, it's kind of like throwing the bucket of water in the deep end or the shallow end of the pool. Something's going to get cut because, well, we had to cut this because we didn't have the money for it, but it doesn't have anything to do with the fact that we cut personal property tax. Well, you can't say that. So if anything gets cut in the next year, you could say, like, well, we could have that.
And Charles County is growing, though, by leaps and bounds.
Yeah, there is context needed, which is if you're in a low services state, generally, like Missouri is, it's a different context. It's a different set of decisions to be made than, say, Illinois, where there's an argument that the taxes are too high, and that, you know, many, you know, and not that everybody thinks their taxes are too high, but the fact is, if you look empirically, Missouri is in the bottom, sometimes the very bottom, and at least the bottom third of all the states in virtually everything that matters.
But these are regressive taxes, and don't forget, your friends in Illinois, they don't have personal property taxes.
I understand.
That's why so many cars in our state are registered there.
Well, and it goes to the need for Missouri to look comprehensively at its tax, its revenues. But
hey, speaking of cars, and we were, Wendy Wiese, Kia and Hyundai received a letter from the St. Louis City Councilor's office in mid-August, and it said, too many of your vehicles are being stolen by the citizens of St. Louis. Repair the problem within 30 days and get back to us. And the two auto manufacturers did, and they said, it's not our problem. Your people are stealing cars. What? If there are packages stolen by porch pirates, are you going to complain to Amazon and call them responsible? I don't think so. So, do you think that there's anything that's going to happen as a result of any of this?
This is one of those that you're really kind of torn, because I think that we should hold the thieves responsible. If you're stealing a car, I'm not going to blame the car manufacturer, but at the same time, Hyundai and Kia have both offered computer security programs to help the car owners improve or lessen the likelihood that they'll be stolen. And they are offering steering wheel locks. And so to me, that's also an admission that there's something to Sheena Hamilton's.
Yeah, right. And I mean, this is like whatever, the corporate dance. So you knew they, what do you think, they were just going to capitulate?
Say, yeah, you got us.
Yeah,
you sorry. Got us
here. How many million you
yeah.
want? Right.
Right.
Well, no. Now, once we hit a courtroom, it was kind of like the Rams. They're like, oh, you know, we would have to adjudicate this case in St. Louis. That's okay, right. Like, we can't get the venue changed.
Yeah.
Right? So we might want to kind of, once we get closer and closer.
You know what's interesting? Sheena Hamilton, the city councilor, worked for Dowd Bennett. Oh, the law firm that successfully beat Stan Kroenke in court.
And you can't, on one hand, complain when you talk about crime. The city needs to do something. And I don't, do I think it's going to work? I don't think the city ever said it's not the thieves' fault. But it, among the things, and this isn't the only city doing it, that you can do is put some pressure on the automakers. Again, and I... Obviously, that doesn't make
sense. But you know what I do? I will say,
and
Ray,
so
your paper, the RFD, had a very interesting article. I think it was Ryan Kroll, your colleague. He pointed out that 456 thefts in a two-week period in August, the city only prosecuted one person.
Well, and that's the interesting thing. I mean, but that's been that way for a while. But it doesn't, the bottom line is that I think it's worth the city trying. But I also don't have any high expectations.
Oh, okay, as one of the people who opposed the lawsuit against the Rams, and I was proven wrong.
Yeah.
I oppose this lawsuit too. I mean, I think it's ridiculous that if these cars are easily stolen, people quit buying them. You know, the market has a voice in this, and I don't think you can blame the automaker for people stealing cars.
Well, a lot of mine are bought them as used cars, and they're like kind of might be in a situation where, like, you know, they can't be, you know, picky about, look,
true,
I got a loan,
cheaper because
and they're cheaper. But right. Also, there's right. something to the fact that these cars are getting stolen all the time. This is not happenstance.
Right.
You know, this is not, you went through it and said, like, man, people just seem to be stealing this kind of car. No,
it's not the only car being stolen.
And we haven't talked about this TikTok video that went viral that apparently instructed the thieves how to get away with this type of theft.
Could you send me that link?
I will tell you this. I think we don't agree on much, but we should be able to agree that Bill McClellan gets none of that Rams money.
There you go.
None. You better still be driving.
And
if you're driving a new car after this Rams money gets out,
I know it.
We're gonna
I
was the one originally proposed we divided it up equally.
Right, And I don't deserve any of it.
But I think you got to recuse.
We'll address that topic and just around the corner when it comes to the Rams money. But first, Ray Hartmann, I want to ask you about Cori Bush. The U.S. representative from the 1st District in Missouri, who, as has been pointed out, was one of the few Democrats on Capitol Hill not to support the $60 million to fund the police. I think some Democrats are trying to show their pro-police street cred by voting for it, but not Cori Bush. And in fact, she proposed an alternative, and that is $100 million for the victims of police violence. Now, she onto something here, or is she really off?
No, I think, well, first of all, the one thing about Cori Bush, whether you like her or don't like her, she, as much as anybody I can think of in Congress, votes her conscience. She does what she thinks, and she's clearly one of those. And I'm not sure how I'd have voted on this particularly, but it's not important because I ain't in Congress. I think that the idea that many people, particularly progressives like Cori Bush, are convinced that more police are not the answer and that there is a crisis for victims of police violence. So I don't have any problem with her voting her conscience.
Okay, you know, Marjorie Taylor Greene votes her conscience.
Right.
And right. I don't support anything that she supports.
But I don't.
And Cori Bush votes her conscience, but I don't support anything that Cori Bush thinks. I mean,
it's fine.
You know, defunding the police and we need fewer police. That's not, I just don't think that's the answer.
I don't
at all.
Either, but I also.
Doesn't she still have a personal security?
Yeah, you know, look, that's got, I don't.
Detail.
So I'm not a defund the police person, never have been, but I don't have any problem with her advancing the idea.
Or Marjorie Taylor Greene advancing her stuff?
That doesn't mean I can be a lot more sympathetic to one than another. I have a few points.
Well,
I think one
is a little bit
they're
more extreme
equivalent.
Than the other. Now, I disagree with the whole defund the police, and that she could have just left that out of it. I think in the release, in the announcement, and we did a story on it in The American, I think there's a little too much hyperbole about the police in it. I think basically if you just make the statement like, no fault, But if a child is, or a young person is killed by a police officer, that's very traumatic on the family, and we should find some way to help them get some kind of mental health counseling. Right. Just leave it at that. There was no need to really bash the police and, right, you know, all that. So I have no problem with that. Once again, whoever decided to call it defund the police, you know, just need to be, come on. That was just a horrible, horrible idea. All right, you take this money, and you don't even have to say, I don't want to give him the money. Give him the money, but let's find, with this money, let's find a way to make it.
I think any time anybody has a child killed on the street, they need help with mental health. So if Cori Bush wants to say, you know, that for anybody who loses a family member, we're going to have mental health help, I would be more supportive of that.
But you asked, I don't have her statement that you pointed out, the American, I do generally agree with it, and I do not think there's any equivalency to an insurrectionist. I'm sorry. I just don't.
Okay, Ray, let me ask you this, though. Speaking of insurrectionists, Jeff Rorta, the business representative, and that was a joke. I'm not calling him an insurrectionist.
I laughed.
But Jeff Rorta, the business agent for the Police Officers Association in the city of St. Louis, is not going to be working for them anymore. Right. It was an announcement that was broken by your paper.
Well, by Sarah Fenske in particular, and the RFT. It's no longer mine. I worked there.
You worked there.
It was a good scoop for the paper. I think a lot of us think it was long overdue. I mean, you know, for sure, that Jeff Rorta, you know, hit the bricks. And what I thought was kind of interesting was that the way the paper broke it is, they came across emails from the police union to the city. These are official emails saying, take Jeff Rorta off all correspondence, all negotiating correspondence right away. And it seems like, you know, my question, we don't have the answers. Well, when were you planning on telling us? And I think if you want to have police they give lip service to want to have good relations in the community, want police, you know, to somehow have a better, you know, image and stuff, it doesn't make sense not to be candid and transparent on something that is a pretty big deal. They should have announced
when Mayor Jones was elected, one of the things I said is, like, listen, you got to find a way to call in the hierarchy of the police and say, like, okay, if we're ever going to have any kind of relationship whatsoever, this guy has got to go. Right. And I think it took, a year and a half or whatever. And it just seems to me that ice may be thawing just a little bit, or something is going on where they said, like, you know what, we got some good things maybe coming our way, and Jeff is in the way of it.
That's good.
You know, somebody could say the exact same things he does, but say it in a way that is not so irritating, and I think that's progress.
Right, this is a good thing, and I suspect, Ray, that maybe the union, the association, was divided about this.
Well, they are.
And maybe that's why the leadership of the union wasn't trumpeting the fact. But overall, it's a good thing.
Okay. Let's ask you to hold that thought, because we want to hear from you on the 9 line. And Tyrone from Illinois called and had this question for us.
I'd like to ask all the guests, what would they think the money that Cronkley should be used for, each one of them individually? Thank you.
Yeah, $512 million. We touched upon this a little bit earlier. Ray, you've talked that money should go to mental health.
Well, only a little piece of it, but I use as an example. What I was trying to make the point was something people could broadly agree upon, which I think, again, back on that subject, mental health-related solutions. And then I think it's, and the things that could be across city and county borders. That's what I was suggesting. There's a lot of uses.
I think the city portion, not the whole $512 million, but the city's portion, some should go directly to St. Louis Public Schools for the hiring of teachers, increase pay, or bring really good, I'm making it sound like they don't have really good teachers, but, and then you can reduce class size. That should be the goal.
Okay, and I would say the city, it should be for police officers, more of them and higher salaries, and garbage men, more garbage men.
I agree with both of those, Bill, and I will add to it early childhood education, because that cannot be neglected or overlooked in any way if we're going to move forward as a world-class city.
I think those are all good ideas. I'll throw one more in. I was on Del Mar, Forest Park Parkway, also on North Kings Highway, and the terracotta planters that are in the medians are really not looking good. There's no plant material. You go to other cities, other parts of the area, like Kings Highway near the hospital, they look great. And there's a WashU medical grad named Eugenia South, who's now at the University of Pennsylvania. And she says that if you can clean up an area and green it up, you will calm everyone down, and it actually reduces homicides, believe it or not.
That is true.
I believe that.
So we may have to get her on next up. But thank you so much, Tyrone. Don't forget, folks, you can call the 9 line. We'll tell you how in just a moment. First, let's go to the mailbag. Regarding Bill's comment on Vic Faust's verbal assault of a coworker, being off air doesn't make it a private tirade. This was workplace harassment of an employee by another employee. That from Carol Woody. Thank you. Karen Clark wrote, to be fair, could you mention how many debates Trudy Bush Valentine has turned down? We think that's one, Ms. Clark. You can write us care of 9PBS, 3655 Olive Street, 63108. We love your emails, Donnybrook at 9PBS.org, and those tweets. Use hashtag DonnybrookSTL. Call that 9 line at 314-512-9094. Thanks, Tyrone, by the way. You can also listen to us on your favorite podcast source, Apple, TuneIn, Spotify, and Google Play. There's no tuna fish. Could have been. Hey, in a moment, we're going to talk to Mark Montavani. Alvin and I will. Mark Montavani is the Republican candidate for county executive in St. Louis County, and he's going to join us next on Next Up. I hope you do, too. Thank you so much.
Donnybrook is made possible by the support of the Betsy and Thomas Patterson Foundation and the members of 9PBS.